Our first scripture comes from Romans 8, verse 29 to 30. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called, and those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified.
Our next scripture comes to us from 1 Corinthians 15, verses 45 to 49. Thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are of the dust, and as is the man of heaven, so also are those who are in heaven. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven.
Thank you, Joseph and Ingrid. Carissa, I don't know. No wonder Satan worked so hard to keep you from singing. I thought that as that song came on, I thought, man, no wonder we had trouble. That was powerful and it was beautiful, and worthy is his name. And I think we forget how worthy his name is, how we need to glorify the Lord, how it is him that gives us everything we need. It is him that raises us above our circumstances. It is him that gives us the strength to carry on in this life. It is him that gives us the wisdom to discern good and evil. It is him. Worthy is his name. And that song just, I thought, oh, I could just sit and listen to it for a couple days, I think. It was beautiful. And we need to remember that worthy is his name. And that to bear his image, to carry his image to the world, is one of the greatest privileges and honors that we can have as a people. And I think the church has forgotten that we bear the image of Christ wherever we go. That no matter where we are, what we're doing, what we're putting out on social media, what is happening, we are bearing Christ's image. And so today, I don't really know exactly where I'm going to go, because this House of Representatives came to me. Of course, we're close to an election, and we think about it. Everybody's got their minds on that. I'm going to tell you, church, put your minds on Christ. Put your minds on Jesus, because he is the only way we will be sustained in what is coming down the road. I don't care who gets elected. He is the only way we will be sustained. There's no man that is our Savior. There's no one that can save us but Jesus Christ. And so the House of Representatives, when it came to me, I thought, that's a crazy kind of a thing to come. But we are God's House of Representatives. We represent Christ. Everything we say, everything we do, it's a great responsibility, isn't it? Because we fall, we stumble, we mess up. But we are known as the House of Representatives. Satan hates us because he hates God. He does not want us to flourish. He does not want us to prosper. He does not want us to worship. You know, that song this morning was a worship song. Worthy is your name, Jesus. He wants us to worship. And Satan wants to deny us that every time we turn around. He wants to throw things at us that will keep us from worshiping God's holy name. So Romans 8, 29, 30, 1 Corinthians 15, 45 through 49. We're going to talk a little bit about that. So, Romans 8, and I'm going to start at 28. And we know that for those who love God, now listen, there's stipulations in the Bible. There's requirements in the Bible. There are things in this Word of God people think, oh, God is love, and He's just going to do anything, and blah, 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 blah. There are stipulations for those who do what? Love God. Do you love God? All things work together for good for those who are called according to His purpose. Are you called? Are you called according to His purpose? What is His purpose? His purpose is for us to go out and make disciples, to look for the lost, to go after the least, to help those who are in trouble. That His purpose and His main purpose for us is to worship the Lord. When we get to heaven, we're going to be worshiping. If it wasn't so wonderful and so powerful and so real, why would God have us come to worship? Why wouldn't He just let us come and do whatever we wanted to do? We come, we go to worship. So if you love God, then all things work together for good to those who are called according to His purpose. For those whom He foreknew, He also predestined. So I looked up the word foreknew, and if I can find it here, and it says it means foreloved or loved beforehand. See, God loved us before even He created the world. He knew we were coming. He knew what He was doing. And He predestined us. His perfect plan was to conform us to His image. He didn't predestine the world to go to heaven. He didn't predestine the world to love Him. It is a choice. Deuteronomy 30:19 says, today I set before you life and death. Choose life. When He put Adam and Eve in the garden, He gave them a what? A free will. And they used it, didn't they? They used it. They used their free will. You can use your free will. You can do whatever you want to do. You can. You can desecrate God. You can have trash coming out of your mouth. You can do whatever you want to do. But if you love God, if you love Him, if we love Him, then we know that we are called according to His purpose. That He has called us, He foreknew us, He predestined us to be conformed to the image of His Son. That was His plan, to conform us to the image. Conform means to fashion oneself in the same way. In every area of your life, to fashion yourself in the same way. And so when Paul was talking, his statement was not to conform implies that we have the power to choose to fashion ourselves after either the world's way or life, to choose to submit to the change of the process that God has designed, the sanctification, the glorification. It goes on to say, in order that He might be the firstborn among many brothers. So see, Jesus was the firstborn. He was the firstborn in the Spirit, so that He has many brothers. And those whom He predestined, He also called. So He calls all of us, but we get to decide if we will answer that call or not. And those whom He called, He also justified. And those whom He justified, He also glorified. The image of Christ, to glorify God, is in us. If we love God, If we know we're called according to his purpose, the glory of the Lord is in us. It shines through us. Everywhere we go, God's glory is like just thrown out there. That's what it is to follow Christ. That's what it is to be in his image. And today, I don't know, there's so many images flying around, isn't it? I mean, I don't have Facebook because I'm afraid I would get addicted to it. Seriously. How much time do you spend on your Facebook in the day? How much time do you spend on that stinking phone every day? How much? Think about it. I'm guilty. Let me tell you. I'm guilty too. I'm not preaching to you that the Lord hadn't already preached to me. I want you to take this week, this is a challenge, church, because he's challenged me in this too. Take one day where the only thing you do is answer a phone call or make a phone call if you have to, but do not get on the social media. Peace. Don't get on there. Huh?
Peace.
Okay, Doug. Turn the TV off, too. What? Did I hear anything? No. I'm serious. Take one day and stay off of it. Just a challenge. You don't have to do it. Like I said, make phone calls if you need them. Answer calls, because that's for me. That's part of what I do. But stay off of all the other stuff. All the other stuff. Lay it down. It's interesting. I had a wedding last night to do, and it was a lot of young people there. And when things get a little boring, guess what comes out? I looked around. People were, here they were in a room full of people, and they were all on their phone. Isn't that just like Satan to divide us, to keep us from conversing, to talking together, to being together, to hear what each other has to say? It's really an amazing phenomenon in the world. And you see it in restaurants, you see it as family sitting around eating a meal, and the kids are on the phones. And now I see the parents on the phones as much as I do the kids. I just challenge you, one day, give it a try. Lay it down. It's a distraction. It's keeping you from following Christ. It's keeping you from having your mind on what is going on. Right here. I always give my couples advice, right, Jason and Ingrid? And in the wedding ceremonies that I do. And one of the things that I charged the groom with, especially, was when his soon-to-be wife talked, to be present, to look at her, to hear what she has to say, all you young men and old men and in-between men. Look at your wife when she's talking to you and hear what she's saying. Be present with the Lord. Listen to what he is saying. Give him a chance to speak to you without all the other stuff. How will you ever look like him? How will you ever look like him? If you're constantly distracted over here, how will you tend to what needs to be tended to in your life? If you're distracted all the time by that thing. And like I said, I'm guilty of it too. I know Wayne and I, we went away, I don't know, maybe it was even last year, we went away. And, he said, now the first thing is turn that phone off. I'm like, yeah, but what if somebody wants to call me? Turn the phone off. My golly, it's not the end of the world. To turn the phone off. It has become our second hand, third hand, really. It's there all the time. And Doug, the TV,
I don't mean to point you out because we all got a little addicted to the TV, but what I see coming on the scene is the cell phones and the distractions of the age. So God is trying to glorify himself through us, and here we sit, when we should be looking up, when we should be saying, Lord, help us know what we are to do in these troubled times. Lainey, do you have something to say? Look, she looked up. She's like, yes, I do. So I found a picture. It's one of my favorites. It's Jesus as a shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. There's an image of Jesus that I absolutely love. It's just Jesus as our shepherd, as he just watches over us, so that we can walk in peace no matter what. We know that he is on guard. Now in this picture, Jesus looks pretty, pretty solemn, pretty serene. But you let a bear or a wolf come on the scene, and you're going to see a different kind of Jesus. Because he loves his sheep. He loves his people. And he is always wanting us to grow and be more like him. And the only way we can be more like him is to pull into him and trust him. So then we're going to go into 1 Corinthians 15. I got a lot of markers in here. I don't know if I'm going to get to them all. 45 through 49. So this is Paul. He's talking to the church in Corinth, and he's telling them about the resurrection, and he's telling them all about just some history. And it said, thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. So when the first man, Adam, was made, the Lord said, let us make him in our, what? Image. Okay? So Adam was made in God's image. But he was of dust. He was a living being. The Lord made him. Adam and Eve lived in the garden. They were going to live eternal. They ate from the tree of life. They were going to live. As long as they ate from the tree of life, they would live. He was going to bear the image for eternity. I mean, I just realized that as I was reading it, because as long as they ate of the tree of life, they would be alive. And so then they ate from the tree of the good and evil, and they had the knowledge that if they live forever, it could be bad. So they, I lost my train, my place here. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. So see, Adam and Eve walked with God. They knew God, but apparently it was not enough to keep them from sinning. So the first man was from the earth, a man of dust. That's what we are, men and women of dust. The second man is from heaven. The Lord had to send his son Jesus to save us. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are of the dust. And as is the man of heaven, so also are those who are of heaven. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven. So right now, we have these earthly tents, we have these earthly bodies, but one day we will not. One day we will not be in them. We will take on the spiritual image of Christ. So for now, as we are the dust, we are flesh. As we grow and we learn to know Jesus more and we look to him more, we become more and more like him in the spirit. That out of us shines the light of Christ. And everywhere we go, people see the difference because of the Holy Spirit in us. And so the Lord is, or Paul is trying to tell them there, this is what's going to happen. This is how you have to, this is bearing the image of Christ, that we shall bear the image of the heavenly. So I'm going to talk a moment to the church leaders, people that are in leadership, people that are called to a high, they're called, I'm serious about this, and I don't really like it because I'm a pastor, and I am called to a higher standard of living. Anyone who gets in any kind of leadership role in the church, anything, you are called to a higher standard of moral purity and living. Do you like that? If you don't like it, you better get out of your position, even though I hate to say that. The church must require from its leaders the highest standard of moral purity, personal integrity, separation from evil, godly living, and faithfulness to God and His Word. This is not something to mess with. When you are called by God, there are requirements. And I'm probably going to scare everybody away that wants to be on any kind of team. But only with the Holy Spirit can we do it. And do you want to do it? Do you want to achieve that? Do you want the Holy Spirit to be living in you so that all these things will come? I did write down here, church leaders need our prayers. They need our encouragement and support. While they set believers an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. There are things that the church right now, the world is looking at and saying, why don't they look any different than we do? I've seen things out on social media of people that I know go to church every Sunday. Now, I don't have Facebook, so people have to show me this stuff. It's a sad state of affairs. It is. What is on your social media? What is out there about you? What pictures do you have on there? Do they glorify God? Do they glorify God? Now, they don't have to. You can do what you want to do. Right? But if you love God, if we love God, and we want to be conformed to His image, and we want to carry His image to the world, is the world looking at your social media? Are they looking at all that? I mean, we put stuff out there for the world to see. You know, there's a scripture that says, don't cast your pearls before swine. I used to think, wow, that's really a weird scripture. I know exactly what it means now. Why do you put your personal stuff out there for people you don't even know to see? I don't know if you all do that. I have no idea. I don't keep check on you. But the Lord does. He sees and He knows. He knows what's going on. And that's something that we have to be aware of if we want to bear His image. In Romans 12:2, it says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. That is, by testing, you may discern what is the will of God, what is good, acceptable, and perfect. So if we have to be transformed, we have to be changed. We have to start to look like the Lord. So these little babies that are being born, my little Adelaide, you know, she's born, she looks one way. And as she grows, she starts to look different. Like she fills out. She doesn't really look like what she looked like when she was born. Tekoa, I remember when she was born, by the time she got to be one or two, I thought she doesn't even hardly look like the little one that was, because she's constantly being changed and conformed and transformed into what God has made her to look like and to be. And that's what He is doing with you, church. He is transforming you into who He wants you, He's called you to be. Are you struggling with it? Are you struggling with who God wants you to be? Maybe you don't want to be that person. Maybe you don't want to be called. Maybe you don't want to be transformed. Maybe you just like it the way you are. Well, that's okay. The Lord's going to let you decide. He's going to let you decide how that's going to work. And one day we will answer. So Titus, let's see, 2:11-14. For the grace of God has appeared. Who is the grace of God? Come on, let's wake up. Who's the grace of God? Jesus. Jesus bringing salvation for all people, training us. He trains us. Remember we talked last week about training? He's training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this, what age? Yesterday? Last week? Present. Present age. Right now. Say you messed up last week. Start again. In this present age, right now, right now, start renouncing the things that you know are not right. Waiting for our blessed hope. As we're doing this, we are waiting for Jesus Christ to come. Are you ready to meet him? Are you ready? He could come. He could come right now. He could say, Karen, get out of the pulpit. I'm here. Jesus could come. Are you ready? We are to be renouncing all these things. We are to be in training to be like Christ. And we are to be waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to, does anybody have their Bible open? Purify us. Make us pure. That's a job, isn't it? That's a job. But he comes to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous, excited, on fire, ready for good works. To go out and tell others about Jesus. Are you excited? Come on, now. What if we are at the Redskins football game? Would you be excited then? Who would be like, yeah, oh yeah, go, go. Look at those football stands filled with fans. I mean, what if the church would act like that about Jesus? Yeah, Jesus, go. Show us how to, get a touchdown. Yeah, let's get this person saved. Let's go after that one. Let's pray for this one. Let's get excited about church. Instead of dragging yourself out of bed on the morning saying, oh man, I gotta go. If I'm not there, Karen's gonna call me. Get excited about being a follower of Jesus the Christ. Because when he comes, if we haven't, woe to us. Follow him. Bear his image. Let others know who you belong to. Who do you belong to? 1 Peter 1 says, therefore, preparing your minds for action. Preparing your minds for action. Preparing your minds. How can you prepare your mind for action in the body of Christ when you're doing this? Huh? How? How are you preparing your mind for Christ's coming? How are you getting ready when you're looking at everything that is not Christ-like? And I don't know that. I'm just saying. How? How are you doing it? I don't know. If you're like me, I can be a real multitasker. But I'm telling you, when I sit down in here, I have to fight not to be distracted. And who loves it? Who loves more than anything to distract you from reading the Word of God? Who? That's right. And how many of us sit down to read our Bible and the phone will ring? Or you think, you hear the pot on the stove boiling over, or which happens to me many times. Or you hear, or you think, you know what, I need to go. I need to go check on that. I remember I need to do this. I mean, the distractions are endless. When you have children, oh my golly. You need to almost put a, I read a story one time for you young moms. This lady had, I don't know, 8 or 9 children. And she, when she would go to the sink to wash dishes, she would throw her apron like up over her head. And the children would know she was praying, let her alone. Yeah, she had trained them. This is mommy's time with the Lord. Think what a witness that was. I should have thought, I wish I had heard that when my kids were little, because I was like, it was crazy. But we need our time with the Lord, and we need to be praying for each other to have time with the Lord. So it says, preparing our minds, getting our minds ready. Satan is after our mind. He's after our minds, he's after our will, and he's after our emotions. That is our soul. That's what he's after. Our mind, our will, and our emotions. That's what he's after. When you get emotionally out of control, he is happy. So we have to continue to understand what he's after, what he, the buttons that he pushes, things that he does. So, and being sober-minded, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus the Christ. So we're to be sober-minded. We're to set our hope on the grace that will be brought to us at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Do you know, there you have a revelation. When all of a sudden you understand who Jesus is, all of a sudden it's like, whoa, I actually see who he is. Like, he's real. Like, he's Lord. I see him. And it's a revelation to you. And you get that revelation, but there's more. There's more revelations as you live and you grow and you become more like him. You get revelation after revelation of who he is. And as you do that, you start to take on the image of who he is. Of who he is. So at our prayer time Friday, it was very powerful. And we were praying, and the Lord was reminding me of things that he had done for me in the past. And I would ask that all of you would sit and think a little bit about what the Lord has done for you in the past. And as we prayed and we talked about some things, when New Beginnings started and we were not really anything at the time, we were not a fellowship, we were nothing. We were just a group of people that followed the Lord. That's what we were. And I had the opportunity to join with Church of the Brethren or not. And I didn't know what to do. I didn't want to be yoked with some of the belief systems in that denomination. And I didn't want the people to be either. And so we prayed about it. We didn't know what to do. And then along comes Covenant Brethren Church. And I went and met with them. And they were such godly men. And as many of you that have met them, you can attest to that. They are godly men. And they love the Lord. And they just want to follow him. It's biblically sound denomination at this point. And so I remember when we chose to do that, to go with Covenant Brethren, not to follow them, but to go with them, be yoked with them. Because the word says not to be unequally yoked with unbelievers, of people that have strayed off the path. When you're yoked with them, eventually you will stray too. Eventually you will compromise too. So I remember the day. It was very, like, I remember it like yesterday. And I got a call from Church of the Brethren. They said, your ordination has been canceled. You are no longer a minister. You're not ordained. And I thought, well, here I have this church, and they don't have an ordained minister. And I'm like, Lord, I don't even know what to do. I don't know what to do. So that day I prayed and I sought the Lord on it, and I was fretting, I was upset. And that evening, it was about 5 o'clock, I got a call from Grover Dooling. He said, your ordination has been approved. You are officially an ordained minister in the Covenant Brethren Church. Same day. Only God could do that. And we need to be reminded of what God does for us. When we think he doesn't care, he cares. When we think that what we do or how we're living or our loved ones are maybe going the wrong way or things are happening in our life, God cares. And all he asked of us is to cry out to him and to carry his image to the world. To know that he never leaves us nor forsakes us. To know that whatever happens, he will make a way. And I have seen it over and over and over again. From the beginning. Even from the name. When all we came together as a group, New Beginnings was our name, because it was all new. None of us knew what we were doing. We just know we wanted to follow Christ. That's what we wanted to do. And God was with us, and he is still with us, and he's still opening doors, and he's still doing miraculous things. And he's still moving us in directions that I know he's calling us into, a children's ministry, a young men and women's ministry to help keep their babies. There are things that he's calling us into, and he'll make a way. I never doubt that he'll make a way. And any situation that's in your life right now, anything that just seems impossible, God will make a way. He'll make a way. I am a perfect example of God making the way. Just don't give up. Just love him. Just remember his faithfulness. Remember who he is. Because all things work together for good to those who love God. It doesn't mean it's going to be easy. Most of the time it's not. That every time you're tested, every time you go through something, God is growing you up. He is perfecting your image and the image of all those around you. That's what he does. He is a righteous, holy, loving, caring, mighty God. And he cares about everything. He cares about everything. I had a lady tell me years ago, she was a deacon of the church. She says, well, I asked her if she'd prayed about something. Well, I don't want to bother God. That's such a little thing. I said, so I guess you think he doesn't see what's going on? He cares about the little things. You know, when Kathy and I were cleaning houses, we called it the little things cleaning business, because we care about the little things. The little details, the little things when we would go in, we cared about those. And it always reminded me of the Lord, because he cares about every little thing. And when you start to understand that, realize it, and know it, then God starts to conform you into his image. He transforms your life into something you never thought it could be. Wayne and I were talking the other day, and he said, and I said, it's been a while ago, I guess now. I said, it's been quite a ride. I mean, it has been quite a journey. And I think all of us can say that to a certain extent. When you're with the Lord, you just don't know what he might do. You don't know where he might take you. Where you are is not where you're going to be. Do not get discouraged. Do not give up. If you're looking for something, he will make a way for you. If you're praying about something and you it's a desire of your heart and you know it's for the Lord, it's his will, he will give you the desires of your heart. He's put them in there. He'll give them to you. And then he will bring them to come to pass. If you're in financial trouble, if your children have gone astray, if you're looking for a spouse, whatever is going on, God will make a way for that. But while you're waiting, serve him, honor him, give him his due. Take the time to be still with him and know that he is God. And know that he will make a way. And don't give up. Persevere. Push through. Keep yourself from ungodliness. Keep yourself from unbelief and compromise. Keep yourself from the ways of the world. And God will move in your life. He will. Can I hear amen?
Amen.
He will move. We are to reflect God's glory. We are to spread the message of salvation. We are to continue on no matter what. We are to continue preaching, teaching, living the gospel. 2 Thessalonians 2:10 says, when he comes on that day to be glorified in his saints and to be marveled at among all who believed. I think I'm going to go there and read all that because I want to share that. And then I'm going to close if I can find Thessalonians. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, Thessalonians. There you go. I learned that in Sunday school hundreds of years ago. 2:10. It says, it's all good. It's all good. Now concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered together to him, we asked you, brothers, not to be quickly shaken in mind or alarmed, either by a spirit or a spoken word, or a letter seeming to be from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord has come. Let no one deceive you in any way, for that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction, who opposes and exalts himself against every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God. These things have to happen, church, before the coming of the Lord, proclaiming himself to be God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And you know what is restraining him now, so that now he may be revealed in his time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains it will do so until he is out of the way. That's talking about the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, right now, the church who has the Holy Spirit is restraining the end days. I do believe it. The Holy Spirit is holding God's hand. God is holding his hand so as many can be saved that can be saved. So the church has work to do. The Holy Spirit is restraining the evil one. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will kill with the breath of his mouth and bring to nothing by the appearance of his coming. All this evil you see, everything that's going on, will be as nothing. He will bring it to nothing. So the church has to understand, as we bear his image, we may get persecuted. There may be things come down along the pike, but Jesus, with the breath of his mouth, will bring to nothing the appearance of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is by the activity of Satan, with all power and false signs and wonders, and with all wicked deception for those who are perishing, because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. Therefore, God sends them a strong delusion so that they may believe what is false, in order that they all may be condemned, who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. So the wicked deception for those who are perishing, that's what's, it's coming. It's, I believe it's here. There's a strong delusion on the earth that they just cannot see Christ. They just cannot follow him. They're being deceived and deluded. So as we, the believers, when he comes on that day to be glorified in his saints, when Jesus Christ comes, we will be glorified. We will be glorified by him, and we will go with him. That is what will happen. And as we bear the image of Christ and the glory that's upon us when Christ comes, and we will actually marvel. It says we will marvel at that. To be marveled at among all who believe. We'll be like, whoa, that's the truth. That was true. It's true what we believed. And we will have the glory of the Lord all over us. That is how we're to be walking every day as believers in Jesus Christ. That's how we're to be living every day. Be careful what you put out on this social media. Be careful what I think I'd heard that even text and things from back in colleges, they can pull up and look at, and you can maybe not even get a job because of it. There's lots of things that we need to be careful of. Don't put your precious stuff out for everybody to see. Because what are they going to do with it? What is Satan going to do with it? But to use it against you. Bear God's image wherever you go. Stay away from ungodliness. Stay away from compromise. Stay away from deception. Stay away from things that might come out of your mouth that shouldn't come out of your mouth. Stay away from it. Be careful what you look at. One image, a picture is worth 1,000 words, would you say? Sometimes I'll see a picture on my phone that I'm like, what? And it'll stick with me. Does anybody else have that trouble? It'll stick with me for days. So as believers in Christ, as disciples of Christ, if you're following him, these are things that we need to do, that we need to think about. How are we following him? How are we bringing glory to the Lord? How are we bearing the image of Christ? It's just something to think about this week, church. How do we bear that God's image? How do we glorify him, whatever we do? I mean, everything. It's a big task. I know. It is. But you know what I believe about new beginnings? I believe we can do it. I believe we can do it. And I believe the Lord will convict us and show us how to live out this life for him and glorify our God. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.